So now I want to explain to you briefly about a type of protein or enzyme called a restriction endonuclease. And these are, again, proteins that are present in many bacteria. And these are their natural defense systems against invaders, organisms that might try to inject their own DNA into these bacteria. So these bacteria have a class of proteins, enzymes, that are called restriction endonucleases. And what these enzymes do, I'll have a blob here that is a restriction enzyme or a restriction endonuclease. It's just a representation of the protein. And what they do is they recognize specific DNA sequences. So we might have a restriction enzyme that recognizes the sequence GAATTC. And so I'm writing some excess DNA sequence here outside of the recognition sequence of this restriction enzyme. And remember that when I write a DNA sequence from left to right, this is the 5' end of the sequence, and this is the 3' end. If we wrote in the complementary sequence, we would have GAC, C, TTAAG, TAG. Again, because we know that the nucleotides pair up according to hydrogen bonding, C is pairing with G's, and A is pairing with T's. And these restriction enzymes will bind to their recognition sequence, in this case, again, GAATTC, and that enzyme will actually cut the DNA molecule. In this case, there's a specific enzyme that I'll tell you its name in just a second that cuts the DNA like that. So it makes an actual chemical cleavage between this G and this A and between this G and this A. And you might realize already that this sequence, when you look at the double-stranded sequence, is a palindrome. When you read from 5' to 3' on the top strand, this is GAATTC. And this is the same sequence when you read the other strand of DNA from 5' to 3', GAATTC. So that's a palindrome. Most restriction enzymes recognize palindromic sequences of some sort. And so you'll notice that when it cuts both strands of the DNA, it cuts between G and A, and it cuts between the same G and A on the opposite strand. This is a restriction enzyme that's called ECOR1. ECOR1 is the enzyme that cuts at a GAATTC. And ECOR1 is named after, first, the bacterium it was isolated from, E. coli. So we use the first letter represents the genus name of the bacterium, and the second two letters, the C and the O, come from coli. And that's how restriction enzymes are named. R for restriction enzyme, and 1 presumably being the first such enzyme that was isolated from E. coli. Now, this enzyme produces what we call sticky ends. So once this cut is made, you can see that one DNA strand from 5' will have CTG, G, then there's a break, and then we have the rest of the sequence, A, and so on. If we look at the other strand, again looking left to right from the 3' end, we have, again, the base pairing, GAC, C, excuse me, C, and then TTAA. So there's a 3' end of that molecule there, but the 5' end of the strand it's base paired with, here are the hydrogen bonds. Right? These nucleotides now, the T, the A, and the A, are no longer base paired with any nucleotides on the opposite strand because this break has occurred due to the cutting by the restriction enzyme. This is called a sticky end. This enzyme produces sticky ends because these four nucleotides are hanging off the end of the chromosome and they have nothing to base pair with. So their hydrogen bonds are actively searching for other DNA molecules to hydrogen bond with. There's a different class of restriction enzymes that don't produce sticky ends. They produce blunt ends. So we might look at, for example, the DNA sequence CCCGGG on one strand, and then the other strand, again, is a palindrome. So you can read from left to right C's and G's in the opposite strand in the reverse polarity from 5 prime and reads the same, CCCGGG. There's an enzyme here, a different restriction enzyme, that will cut right in between the C's and the G's. So when those molecules separate, you have two blunt ends. You have one pair of strands that are base paired there on this side of the cut, and then you have another segment of chromosome over here, still base paired together. So there are no single nucleotides or chains of nucleotides in the middle that aren't still base paired after this enzyme cuts. This enzyme is called small one. It's from a bacterium called Serratia marcescens, and it makes a blunt cut. It still recognizes 6 nucleotides, it's a palindrome, but it's a blunt cutter, not an offset or a sticky end cutter. Having discussed single nucleotide polymorphisms and mutations, now it's interesting to consider how a mutation might impact the ability of a restriction enzyme to recognize and to cut a DNA sequence. For example, if there was a single nucleotide polymorphism here, such that the sequence of a chromosome looked like this, now we no longer have GAATTC. We have a C here, and so the restriction enzyme ECOR1 wouldn't recognize this sequence and would not be able to cut this molecule of DNA. This one, yes, but because of this single nucleotide polymorphism or SNP, no restriction digest, no cutting of the DNA molecule would be able to occur. And this is one tool that geneticists use to distinguish one chromosome, chromosome A, let's say, from an individual that has a different genotype, a different nucleotide at the same position on the same chromosome. You can extract DNA molecules from individual A and from individual B, and you could apply this enzyme, you could add the protein, ECOR1, to the DNA sample, and you could then assess, did that enzyme cut the DNA molecule or did it not? And that would be one way to determine whether or not those two individuals, individual A and individual B, shared the same sequence, or if they had a sequence that either abolished gets rid of, this mutation gets rid of a restriction site, or you could also have mutations that take a chromosome that, say, doesn't have a restriction enzyme site. If there was a mutation from a C to a G, that would create a restriction enzyme site that would allow an enzyme to digest this piece of DNA. So I'm going to leave you with a couple of questions to think about for our next class. The first one is, what enzyme cuts this sequence? So I'd like you to figure out if you can learn this information by yourself, GCG, GCC, GC. So what is the name of the enzyme and what bacterium did it come from? The second question, so that's question one, my second question for you to think about and to bring answers next class is, here's a DNA sequence. What mutation to that sequence would make a HindI3, so we want a mutation, would make a sequence that can be digested by the enzyme HindI3? That's from Haemophilus influenzae. It's the D3 version of that enzyme. So think about those two questions for next class.